Carrie Cassidy from Project Camelot, and we're here with Luca Scantamburlo.
Nice pronunciation. Very good.
And we're very excited to be here with him somewhere in Italy. We can't say where. And we're going to be covering some very interesting topics. Luca is an accomplished journalist, and he is also in contact with Cristoforo Barbato, and we are very interested to hear what Barbato has to say. And Luca has had has written articles on what Barbato has covered. We're very interested in the Vatican connection and what you can tell us about that.
My name is Luca Scantamburlo. I am 33 years old. I was born in Italy. And I got a qualification in journalism. Moreover, in the last 2-3 years, I wrote several articles about controversial affairs, UFOs, possible extraterrestrial presence on Earth and in the solar system. And one of my articles, an adaptation, was published also on Nexus New Times, which is a bimonthly magazine published in Australia.
Perhaps you can tell us how you got in contact with Cristoforo Barbato.
Yes. Cristoforo Barbato was born in Naples in 1972, and my first contact with him was in 2002. He was editor-in-chief for a national magazine, and its name was Stargate Magazine. Over there, on the bottom, there are some copies of the magazine, the Italian magazine, for which Barbato was editor-in-chief, Stargate Magazines, on the right. And on the left, there is a copy of a, it's like a tableau of another magazine for which Barbato worked in Rome. Exactly, carry. The name is Extraterrestre. Now it doesn't exist anymore. And that one was one of the magazines which talked about UFOs and related phenomena. I'm sorry, I don't have a copy of another magazine which is missing here, for which Barbato worked. It was Stargate. No Stargate magazine, like them, just Stargate. And that magazine, Barbato, wrote several articles about the third secret of Fatima. That time, I didn't buy them, even I didn't know them. And in 2002, I asked Barbato if he was interested to publish one of my work. And then, in 2002, he published one of my articles. Another one came out in 2003. And what happened in 2003, that magazine closed. So at that time, Cristoforo Barbato was not editor-in-chief anymore. He lost the job. And then he came back home. And you know, we never met each other at that time. We just had email contacts, phone calls. And what happened later, in 2005, what happened? I read a short article about Cristoforo Barbato's research. And that article was about a strange footage who showed to the public for the first time in April 2005 in Pescara. Pescara is a big city on the Adriatic coast. The Adriatic is one of the seas of the, here that we have in Europe. And I was very curious because in the article, the report was saying that that footage came from a Vatican insider who contacted Cristoforo Barbato in 2000, year 2000. And after a few contacts, Cristoforo Barbato got this footage, and he showed to the public for the first time in 2005. But that footage at that time was not available in the web. It was 2 minutes footage, and so I wrote an email to Cristoforo Barbato, and I asked him if there was any chance to see the footage, because the footage, as I told you, was not available. And he told me, oh, yes, you can come to a conference. I have been invited to a conference in Santa Maria Maddalena, which is a small village in Italy. And in that occasion, we can meet each other, and you can have the possibility to show the footage, because I'm not going to give the footage to anybody, because the condition when I received the footage were very strict.
Isn't it true that Barbato kept quiet about his contact with this Vatican insider for several years?
Yes.
Before he released any of the information?
Yes, this is you underpointed an important aspect. Just a little chronology to understand what happened. In year 2000, he received the first messages by email and by post, the normal post and the email. And of course, he was very skeptical. At the beginning, this man qualified himself as a Vatican insider. And little by little, a relationship grew up. And of course, even at the beginning, this deep throat gave to him a lot of information. But Barbato was not satisfied, because you know better than me, Carrie, Bill, that the word insiders, the insider's word, is very dangerous, because it's very difficult to distinguish the truth and the false information. So he was not satisfied, and he asked him a meeting. You know,
yes.
I can imagine that for the insider was a difficult request, mm-hmm. because if he is not an impostor, he's risking his life and maybe the life of somebody else. But in spite of everything, the meeting took place. More than one.
More than one. And do you know where it took place?
Yes, because Barbato made the news public.
Mm-hmm.
The first meeting, even the second one, took place in year 2001 in Rome, in a public space. I don't know where. Barbato never told me. Of course, I can understand it.
I imagine that Cristoforo would have asked his source, why are you telling me this information?
Yes, this came out even in the interview that I had with Cristoforo Barbato, because during the interview that he gave me, the interview was published in April 2006 on the bimonthly magazine UFO Notiziario in Italy. But he gave me the interview a few weeks before, because we arranged the interview. It was a written interview. I had not the possibility to meet him. And I asked him the same question. Why he is doing this? Why he did such a thing? And the answer is in the Jesuit's words, because the Jesuit and some of his colleagues, which are part of an intelligence structure, an intelligence agency, presumed intelligence agency, because officially the Vatican has not an intelligence agency, him and other colleagues I think they had a moral problem. They knew that the events that sooner or later will come in the following years, even now, because this happened in the past, it happened in year 2000, would involve all the creatures of the earth. Nobody excluded.
All the creatures.
All the creatures. It means, of course, every latitude of the planet.
Mm-hmm.
I think they had a moral problem. There is a very famous story in the Greek tradition. There is the so-called Antigone problem. Antigone, the problem of Antigone, you know. There is a law, and if you do not respect the law, there is the risk to hurt your feelings, hurt, you know, your sense of humanity. So you have to make a choice. Follow the laws, the rules, and, you know, destroy your sense of humanity. Otherwise, break the rules to follow.
So this Jesuit came forward. He's a Jesuit.
Yes, but he came forward, he came out only with Cristoforo Barbato, because him and his colleagues chose a person. And that person is Cristoforo Barbato.
And
they made a choice.
They chose him because he was a respected journalist,
for many
editor,
reasons. Yes. This is was
in
absolutely
Italy.
One of them. But the others were, first of all, Cristoforo Barbato was young. You know that the young people are usually, not always, more courageous. Even because when you are getting older, you have more responsibilities. Maybe you have a family, maybe you have a reputation, you know, normal story.
So Cristoforo was how old when he was approached in 2000, do you know?
He was born in 1972, so he was 28 years old.
Ah.
But the problem is there are other reasons, of course, more than one. Cristoforo Barbato, in my opinion, is a loyal person. You cannot buy him. This is what I think. And he's very tough as guy. And maybe because he's honest.
I see, very good. Okay, because obviously he set the bar fairly high for this Jesuit. In other words, he insisted, first of all, he took a long time to release the story.
Because he was
second
not convinced.
Of all, he checked it out.
He was not convinced. He did a lot of researches to check if the information were accurate, where, you know, the Jesuit gave him a lot of information. He gave him some pictures, a footage on a videotape, not on a CD-ROM, not a DVD-ROM. We are talking about year 2000. He received a parcel post.
Mm-hmm.
Inside there was a videotape, VHS, you know.
Uh-huh.
And
did he have the VHS tested? Do you know?
He converted the video in a digital form, but he did this with no professional equipment, so the quality of the video is not quite high. Also, I think that if we had the possibility, the chance to see the original footage, maybe we could have more information about the, you know, the validity of the footage, because we are talking about the footage of a presumed observation in a deep space, where, of course, you know, the visible light is almost nothing.
And what is the footage showing us?
Yes, the footage. It seems that the footage shows a planetoid not known to the modern astronomy, to the official knowledge of the modern astronomy. It's an editing also. This is another important thing. I mean, there are two different parts put together.
Okay, but it was shot with a camera on spacecraft?
On a space probe, which, according to his deep throat, belongs by secrecy to the Vatican. The name of the space probe would be Siloe. A Siloe, by the way, is a biblical word that you can find in your Bible, in the New Testament, a couple of times. I don't remember the exact point, but anyway, it's a story about what Jesus Christ did during those far days in Palestine. There was a blind man, am I correct? He was not able to see. And Jesus Christ did something and said to him, now you can go to the Siloe source of water, wash your eyes over there, and you will have your sight again. You will have your sight. And this is what the man
is this in English, would we say silo?
Yes, Siloe.
Silo? Yeah.
The spelling is S-I-L-O-E. Siloe.
Okay.
Is a place in Jerusalem which is sacred to the Christians. And this space probe would be part of a space program.
Who is it? Who is supposedly built the space probe?
This presumed space probe would have been produced, arranged in Area 51, Nevada, by the Lockheed Martin.
Ah, okay.
But
now this information is from Deep Throat.
Yes.
All about.
But the main point is this is what I want to underpoint, that before the first meeting between Cristoforo Barbato and this Jesuit, Barbato checked his credentials. And he did this before and even during their first meeting, because the Jesuit showed his credential to Barbato. And on that occasion, of course, Barbato was still, skeptical. You know, he had no doubts anymore on his identity. We are not talking about, on the evidence of the Jesuit footage, on the other pictures, and of the whole story. What Barbato understood without doubts was the identity of that deep throat. He knows the name, the surname, his, what he did. Of course, he has protecting the source of information because of the ontology.
Was he, okay, the organization, the secret organization that this Jesuit is a member of is part of the clandestine intel services of the Vatican, and what is it called?
Barbato received this information. The intelligence agency would be Servizio Informazioni del Vaticano, Vatican Intelligence Service, and the code name would be SIV, from the Italian expression. But what it is very interesting is that Barbato found out later on, on an essay written in the United States, on a historical essay written by John Loftus and Mark Arons, and its name is Ratlines, that there is a reference to this agency, and there is the exact expression that the Jesuit in Italy gave to Barbato, Servizio Informazioni del Vaticano. You can find it on any edition of that book, Ratlines. And this book was even published here in Italy. So I checked with my eyes.
Uh-huh.
And Barbato found out this later.
Right. Okay, but this is, what is the meaning, secretum omega?
Secretum omega would be, according to Barbato's deep thought, the highest level of clearance in this agency.
And is
he's dividing in secretum omega first, second, and third level.
Okay, but anyway, was this Jesuit a member of the highest level?
Yes, he was one of the members of, yes. I don't know at which, I don't remember at which level, because we cut here because, sorry.
That's okay.
You know, it's very difficult for me.
Nope. Start again with this part. So the Jesuit is a member of the highest level, or possibly the highest level of the secret.
Yes. Yes, this is what I have understood. Yes, he was at that time an active member.
Now you're saying was. Is there information that Barbato received that he has left this agency?
I don't know anything about this.
I see.
What I know for sure, at least for a couple of years, they were in contact, but I don't think they are in contact anymore.
Okay.
Moreover, he did his job. He did even more than what he was thinking to do, because Barbato asked a meeting, and you know, this was something that they didn't think about this. But the point is, as I told you, you know, it's very, usually when you have a deep throat, when you have an insider, when you have a source of information, most of the times you don't know the identity. Most of the times. If there is somebody from the Vatican who did this with, of course, the support of other people, you cannot imagine, you know, a single person which belongs to such a high agency. An agency, you know, not of a normal state. We are talking about the Vatican. The Vatican is a small state, you know, but it's a tradition. It's a reputation. Moreover, the importance, you have a state in which you have politics and also you have a faith, you know, you have together. And
so this man is coming forward secretly. He's backed by a couple other people in the Vatican.
I don't know the numbers, but I can imagine a few of them.
Okay.
A minority, of course, because it's not an official position of the Vatican.
Okay, and what they're saying is that there is a planet out in the solar system approaching us, the Earth.
Yes, this is the...
Is it a planet, Luca, or is it just some large body?
An interesting question. An interesting question because, well, what Barbato knew about this, because he had a conversation, he had many discussions, what he knew, without doubt, is that the Jesuit told him that this planetoid, which it seems that is coming in the solar system, would be, according to the Jesuit, it is the so-called Planet X, or the ancient god Nibiru, and Marduk, according to the Babylonians. So Planet X is a scientific expression for something that should be out there. But at least officially up to now, there is no evidence. I mean, indirect evidence there are, but direct evidence, officially observation from some observatories, there aren't officially. But there are indirect evidence that there should be something out there. But the Jesuit pointed out this. That planetary is the Sumerian planet, I mean, what the Sumerians called Nibiru, planet of crossing. That everybody, you know, should be familiar with this, because Zechariah Sitchin, for example, a well-known historian, Russian historian, who lives in New York, wrote many books about this. The Jesuit told Barbato the planetoid is the so-called Nibiru planet.
Do you know what they called it in the Vatican? What their name for it is?
No, I don't know. I can have some ideas about this, because if you look the New Testament, the John's book, the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, there is a passage in which maybe there is a reference to this body, but if you consider that book, the book of Revelation, not just a book about metaphysical or just you know, a future which will involve the spiritual forms. No, if you consider that book as a book with, how can I call them? Future events, but
a prophetic
written in symbolic. In symbolic language, mm-hmm. You know, if you consider that book under these terms, there is a strange passage in which there is a word. This word is wormwood.
Ah, yes.
And it seems that there could be a connection with the strange phenomena. I'm talking about celestial phenomena. Because if I remember well, in that passage, the book is telling us about a strange star which will appear. And this color will be red. And its name is Wormwood.
Mm-hmm.
But coming back to your question, Carrie, I have no idea about what is the name in this secret agency.
Okay, then you can tell us what is the background of the Jesuit? In other words, what did he tell Barbato besides the fact that there was a planet coming? Was it connected with the third secret of Fatima? Was it connected? Because we know that Barbato has written in the past articles about the
third. To answer to your question, one of the main reasons for which the Jesuit and his colleagues decided to contact Barbato was because of his articles published in year 2000 on Stargate, the magazine, the monthly magazine. No, Stargate magazine, which is the following magazine, which was published, but the former one, Stargate, in which Barbato wrote several articles about the third secret of Fatima, especially on the base of the researchers' Portuguese researchers, Fina d'Armada, and the other gentleman is an historian. And that book has a strange title, you know, Extraterrestrial Intervention at Fatima, something like this. You can find any reference you want on the internet. And because of his articles about the first secret of Fatima, and at that time, year 2000, there was also the conference press held by the Vatican, and there was the official revelation by the Vatican of the third secret of Fatima. And if you read the revelation, there is a vision of a bishop dressed in white who dies together with other Christians there is no sign of cataclysms, you know, problems for all the earth. But for example, there is a nice book, this one, written by a very famous Italian journalist. His name is Antonio Socci. He wrote a book and the title is Il Quarto Segreto di Fatima, which in Italian means the fourth secret of Fatima. It doesn't mean that there is the fourth secret. It's just a play of words, but supported by strong evidence, which indicate that there is a part of the secret that maybe was not released to the public yet. And according to this book, to the author, Antonio Socci, he found out that, because of his researches, that maybe the secret written by Sister Lucia dos Santos was divided in two parts. One part is the so-called vision, which was made public and is the official version, according to the author, released by the Vatican in year 2000. But maybe, according to the author, there is another piece of the secret which is still secret. And that one would be the explanation of the vision.
Okay, now this is the vision. The vision was of the bishop in white.
Yes.
With some people.
Yeah, Christians.
Christians.
Who died. Who died in terrible, you know, terrible way.
Because
they don't die because of natural causes. They die because somebody, he is killing them.
Somebody.
Yes. You know, soldiers. If I remember correct.
Okay, now is this written about by Barbato when he talked about the third secret of Fatima?
Unfortunately, I have not the copies of the magazines.
Mm-hmm. But this definitely took the Jesuits' attention, to this.
You got the point. Because of this, because Barbato, of course, was not convinced that message was the original message written by Sister Lucia. That, by the way, it seems that is contained in 20-25 lines in Portuguese language. 20-25 lines. Mm. And if you pay attention to the official version, there is a discrepancy between, because the official version of the first secret of Fatima is longer. But we know that Sister Lucia wrote a lot about the first secret of Fatima, maybe some notes about the vision, and maybe a few lines about the explanation of the vision. And we are talking about what the Blessed Virgin Mary told her in the far year 1917 in Portugal at Fatima. And also, because in this book, you know, there is the research, the historical research, who indicates that Lucia, one of the three children, had a lot of problems to put on the paper the secret, because the secret was, you know, maybe full of difficult things to accept. And if you pay attention to the other secrets, the third and the second, were about wars, the loss of faith, the rise of communism in Soviet Union. We are talking about, you know, planetary events. So it's quite strange, you know, that the first secret is a death of a bishop on some stairways. Does make too much sense, according to me. But anyway, the articles written by Barbato were about even the presence of another child who was a witness of strange phenomena in those days at Fatima. If I remember well, her name was Carolina Pereira, if I remember well. And so the children who were witnesses were four, not three. I mean, in front of the crowd, when there was some miracle, there were three children. But there was another one, the four witness. But most important was the contribution of the Portuguese book written by Fina da Armada. According to Joaquim Fernandes and Fina da Armada, who are the authors of an outstanding book published in Portugal in 1982 about a possible extraterrestrial presence at those times, there was one more child involved in the strange phenomena at that time. Moreover, this is the most important thing. What did they do? They checked the original transcript of the children, what they said at the beginning. Another point that I want to, you know, to make very clear, I'm not saying that the Blessed Virgin Mary does exist. This is very important. We had so many apparitions in Europe, in France, in Italy, you know, even you are, I'm sure, familiar with the Medjugorje presumed apparition in
the
ex-Yugoslavia.
Certainly these are visions and apparitions, as you call them, of what appears to be the Virgin Mary. Anything is possible if it is generated by ETs.
Something happened for sure, because in the last apparition you had thousands and thousands of people who were witnesses of the so-called sun miracle, the miracle of the sun, you know. And of course, under the astronomical point of view, the sun, nothing happened to the sun. Maybe something, you know, came from the heaven, from the sky, and it looked like a sun. It was not a sun. And there were many journalists, and there were witnesses, you know. They wrote articles on the newspapers, the Portuguese newspaper. Something happened at that time. But what the...
What did the children say that they... You said they went back to the original testimony of the children.
Yes, the authors of the Portuguese book checked the original papers where there were, you know, the original words. And they understood that at the beginning the impressions of the children were that there was a strange creature, apparently female. She did not move the lips, for example. She looked like maybe 14, 16 years old. So she was not a woman. Mm-hmm. She was a teenager.
Okay.
She had something in the hands, like a spear. She has a dress, a strange, you know, a strange dress, a strange suit. She did not like the Blessed Virgin Mary. But this does not mean that the Blessed Virgin Mary does not exist, of course. So, because of
so
the Barbato...
So is this what Barbato
article,
wrote about?
Yeah, Barbato studied the Portuguese book. This book is not published in Italy, in Italian. Barbato studied the original one.
Oh, wonderful.
Anyway, because of this, and other consideration made by Barbato on the base of other, you know, churchmen, theologians, and priests, who were not so too much happy about the official version. And Barbato wrote several articles, and you know.
So this had to catch the attention of the Jesuits, and had
were,
to do with why they chose.
But they were following him even before.
I see.
Because,
and you know this because they told him this.
Yeah, I think so. Yes, this is what I understood, you know, from my contacts with Barbato.
Okay, and we're going to speak with him today. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, so here you have this mystery. You have the third secret of Fatima. You have him chosen.
Excuse me if I interrupt you.
Absolutely.
The strange thing is that Barbato did not come out with information about the first secret of Fatima. There is not a single word about the first secret of Fatima. Maybe because it was a choice made by the Jesuits. Maybe because it was a choice made by Barbato. But anyway, according to me, in my opinion, there could be a connection between this planet, which is an intruder, which was an intruder in our solar system in ancient past, and now it seems is a part of our solar system, and the first secret of Fatima.
So are you saying that you're making the connection, but the Jesuit did not make that connection?
No. There is not a single word from Barbato, which, you know, is a link, you know. Barbato did an outstanding work before, but okay. The Jesuit footage came out.
So but you're saying this is sort of what we call a synchronicity. Do you understand when I say that word, synchronicity?
Yes.
It means no. Two events that are happening. But
Barbato is, in my opinion, Barbato is perfectly aware, is conscious what there is behind the first secret of Fatima.
First of all, because he knows.
First of all, because he studied the subject.
Yes.
You know, for example, this book is very important, but does not mention Cristoforo Barbato. But for example, it mentioned Malachi Martin, who was a former Jesuit, very famous in the United States of America. Because
Malachi Martin?
Malachi Martin.
Ah, yes.
He participated to the Coast to Coast talk show.
Absolutely.
Hosted by Art Bell.
Very respected.
And he died in 1999.
That's
but
right.
He did something about the first secret of Fatima. He was not Jesuit anymore because he worked by the Holy See in Vatican in the 60 years of the last century. He was one of the assistants of a cardinal. So, in my opinion, he had the possibility to be involved in some secret aspects of the Vatican affairs. But anyway, in that book, Antonio Socci wrote a few lines about Malachi Martin and is not too much convinced about his witnesses, about his testimony. But anyway, it's important because he mentioned Malachi Martin in that book, and he doesn't mention Cristoforo Barbato researches. He mentioned Malachi Martin because of his statesmen made at Coast to Coast Art Bell Show.
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't mention what Malachi Martin said at Art Bell Show about something that is approaching us, according to Malachi Martin's words. And this is a quite important point.
What did Malachi Martin say was approaching
us?
Do you know?
Yes, I remember. I have the transcript of his words. I can read it for you. But anyway...
That's okay. We can put the words on the screen.
Yeah, I can tell you.
And you can tell us your version.
Yes. The main point is the building of a new telescope by the Vatican on Mount Graham in Arizona. This is an official astronomical site held by Vatican in collaboration with the Arizona University. Mm-hmm. The name is Vatican Advanced Technology Telescope. It is in public domain. They have a website. And the telescope has a mirror with a diameter about 1.8 meter. It's expensive, a few million dollars.
Why is that significant?
Yeah, because it's a little bit strange that you build an advanced telescope if, I mean, the main affairs of your country is keeping the faith, the Catholic faith, alive. So the question made by Art Bell to Malachi Martin was, why did they do this, Father? And the answer of the former Jesuit, Malachi Martin, was the following, if I remember. Because those who are amongst the highest levels of the Vatican and the geopolitics know that what is approaching us could be of great import in the next 5 years, 10 years, unquote. And this was said in 1997. Now we are in 2008, but, you know, the problem is that we are facing radical climate changes. So if you give a look to the scientific articles about climate changes, there is not, you know, just one line. There are different lines. There are many scientists who say, yes, the radical changes, the climate changes, we are guilty of this because of the pollution, because of the...
Right, but they're also saying, and we've interviewed David Wilcock and Richard Hoagland about this, which is saying that the outer planets of our solar system are heating up.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, Richard Hoagland is author, if I remember well, of the first article written in 2003 about climate changes in the solar system.
Mm-hmm.
Was made available on his website.
Yes.
enterprisemission.com.
That's right.
And it was in 2003. One of the most important points was that during the conversation between this deep throat, the Jesuit from the Vatican, Barbato, the Jesuit said to Barbato that this planet, the presumed planet X, Nibiru, would have begun to affect the solar system from year 2004. And this happened in year 2000 or 2001.
So why did Barbato stay silent about the story until 2005? Wasn't it 2005 that he released it?
Yes, he came out from the woods, you know, in April 2005, when he was one of the spokesmen at a conference in Pescara, held by a local association, UFO Observer. For many reasons, but the most important was that he didn't realize his source of information. In spite of, he checked the credential. In spite of, he checked, you know, the studies of Zechariah Sitchin. This is his last book about the Earth Chronicles. And it talks, of course, about...
End of days.
Yes.
If you could hold that up so we can get the...
Of course.
That would be, yes.
And so Barbato did a lot of researches about the information that the Jesuit gave to him.
So it took him that long to become certain that it was okay
to
release.
I think he was afraid, because this story... you interviewed Bob Dean.
Yes.
The former Sergeant Major.
That's right.
And he used an expression that I like so much. About extraterrestrial affairs, about possible extraterrestrial presence in our solar system, he said this. This story is dynamite. Yeah, I perfectly agree with him. This story is dynamite because if Nibiru does exist, first of all, is a threat to all of us. Because its orbit, if it is the orbit described in the ancient text, written in Mesopotamia, is a cometary orbit. So it means that at a certain point this planet will be close to the Sun and close to the other planets. And if its mass is bigger than Earth's mass, we can have a lot of problems. Also because of, I can imagine, this planet has a magnetic field. As a matter of fact, there is a strange behavior in the solar activity. And for a strange coincidence, but I don't believe in the coincidence, this solar cycle, the solar cycle 24, we have its peak, its maximum in year 2011-2012. And this is, doesn't come from me, doesn't come from Jesuit, doesn't come from Barbato, comes from scientific forecast made by NASA employees.
I want to ask, what do the Jesuits say in terms of hard information about this planetoid's orbit and its size and its nature? Whether it's a rocky planet or a big gas giant like Saturn?
It's a planet described by Zechariah Sitchin, so with an atmosphere and with the possibility to have life on the surface. It's the planet described by the Sumerians.
That's what the Jesuits said?
Yes, it's Nibiru. But he said more about the space program that they would have, that the Vatican, by secrecy, would have. We are talking about the SOTTOTITOLI space program. And SOTTOTITOLI space program would be part of a bigger one. And its name is Kerygma. Kerygma is a Greek word. It means proclamation, annunciation.